as the chairman of Société Générale, the first almost but not quite French person heading this very French bank. He will tell us apparently when the next bubble will burst and how we are prepared. Not sure who the we is. Lorenzo, the floor is yours.
Having said that, I didn't say when the bubble, the title is how close are we, which is easier to some extent, but this is a question I guess that any bank, any board, any bank board, any risk committee in banks have to ask themselves when they meet every month. months or every 2 or 3 months. And why is that? Because we all know that we are coming out of a period of huge amount of liquidity, circulating, a period of very low interest rate, search for yield, the impression that this cannot last for long, and the impression that this is creating distortions in the financial markets, and sooner or later this will reverse. And on top of that, when the reversal will take place, what we thought about the liquidity conditions prevailing at some point would probably turn out to be wrong, and the conditions will change very quickly. And it's also relevant because this is the history of financial crisis. You always think that you will be able to get out of the room before the others, and you always think that you will detect when the bubble will burst before the others, and you are safe. And you know, this cannot be true for everybody. There is a collective misfunctioning, I would say, of the intellectual framework and of the way financial markets work. So if you are a few seconds before the others, you may turn out to be safe. So it's very important to ask yourself this question if you operate in markets. And that's the kind of question that our economists, at least, are asked all the time. So I tried, I think I'd like to go quickly, given the time, through some indicators of whether there is or not a bubble, and how close we may be to reaching the top of the bubble, which is the most difficult question to ask. And of course, if the crisis comes, if there is a sharp adjustment, how is our bank prepared, how are the banks prepared, how is the system prepared in general, and how confident can we be? So I think this is a standard question, and that's why I wanted to share with you a bit of a methodological discussion, what we are currently looking at. So let's, I don't need to discuss with you what a bubble is and how it can burst, but what we are looking currently, if we consider the global economy, is basically U.S. equities, bond markets, the Chinese economy, cryptocurrencies, and some other things. That's areas where we ask our economists or market people what their assessment is about the valuations. And then we look at what could trigger the burst of the bubble, what are the factors that can trigger that, and then whether we are better prepared than in the past or not. So just looking at a few, I'm sorry for the those of you who are here who don't see me, but you know, maybe you can imagine the slides. First, the U.S. equity market. Clearly, if I look at some of the prices that we have here, some indicators, we are very close to levels which can be considered as peaks. In terms of valuation ratios, close to historical highs. If you look at the leverage, it's a bit of a scary picture. You see that in the non-financial corporate sector, the debt has gone back to peaks, which corresponded, interestingly enough, with the last few crises. We know that this debt is partly used to buy backs. There are signs of capital misallocation also, M&A operations with debt not used to finance corporate fixed investment, but which remains modest. On the other hand, when you look at all these pictures, some elements which has been seen on the other side. We know that profits, I mean that the tax cuts are going to support profits for some, a few more years maybe down the road that may justify current valuations. And the equity risk premium remains relatively heavy. So, again, I'm not going to tell you we are very close to a bubble, but some indicators suggest that there are some risk of misallocations and price distortions. But on the other hand, there may be elements to consider that this is not yet that stressed and that strained. The other market that we can look is the bond market. Here, interestingly, if you look at this chart, which is the term premium and the deficit and the projections, you see clearly that there is a strange thing happening, that we are projecting in the US where the deficits which are increasing, the debt which is expected to reach within the next 5 years 117% of debt to GDP ratio, which would be among the highest, while the term premium is just not adjusting at all. The low premium is certainly looking strange. On the other hand, there's no decrease of public debt in other economies either, so the piling up of debt is continuing. On the other hand, balance sheet of central banks, and that's the way banks look at it, the fact that the exit from QE will not be very quick, and there will be a rollover of existing debts, the fact that central banks are going to continue to buy, can explain part of the distortions in this pricing. Let's move to another issue, Chinese economy. Certainly here also there are price distortions. If you look at the housing prices in particular, clearly there is a bubble. On the other hand, if you look at the way in which the Chinese have dealt with these bubbles in the past has been quite effective in managing the economy. It doesn't mean that this will continue to go on. There are other indicators in the Chinese economy that suggest also misallocation of resources or the excess capacities in the publicly owned companies, the high corporate leverage. These are sources of concern, but so far the Chinese have been able to use often non-market mechanisms to adjust, and the huge amount of reserves that they have are considered to be an important factor that could be used in the adjustment eventually. This is the indicator I was mentioning to you, the credit to the private sector, in particular the household, is continuing to increase compared to GDP at a very high pace. Last element which is interesting is cryptocurrencies. I won't go too much into that. We've seen prices going up, going down. This is a factor that is also an indicator of excess liquidity and search for Ponzi schemes, I would say, which may, in some parts of the cycle, be a sign that things are getting a bit crazy. So we could look at other markets. I just gave you a few examples. There are signs of bubbles building up in corporate valuations in the United States, corporate bonds in particular. Chinese economy is also bubble prone. Government bond market, that's a bit more difficult to assess whether really there is a bubble there. Cryptocurrencies are certainly in a bubble. question is, will it continue? Will this trend continue? And what could trigger a burst of the bubble? And two type of events. One is a change in underlying factors, what we would call disappointment, the disappearance of the factors that would push for, that are pushing for these bubble building up. And the second is a fragility in the way in which the system would adjust to these disappointments, what we would call creditors run, everybody running to the door, being afraid of these readjustments. So if you look at the first point, disappointment, one issue is economic data. Now we are seeing here a diversification. If you look in particular at the right-hand side, the so-called surprise index. Here you see that there is, while in the US, the index remain on the positive side. In Europe, Japan, Eurozone, UK, we are turning into a negative surprise effect. So we could have a diversification again of the cycle, and we could have some negative news that could lead to a reassessment of the valuations in markets. This could be a first factor that could trigger the effect. And you see how in the Eurozone in particular, over the last few months, there have been substantial downside surprises that could have an impact. Of course, political risk, don't be scared by this picture. Those who follow the markets will not, but certainly political factors like the recent elections and government creation in Italy are changing, may change perceptions, and maybe, you know, waking up calls for the markets that maybe there was complacency. This you can see also in all the indicators of liquidity, and this is also an issue about how an awakening of markets in an environment where markets are more fragmented and in the end less liquid in the sense of having less actors being able to play the role of broker dealer could amplify the adjustment. We may want to come back to this issue later. So the second issue is what is the role of shock absorbers? Do we have shock absorbers in the markets? That's what I was just talking a little bit about. In case of price readjustments, are there non-linearities in access to credit that can be triggering an acceleration of the crisis? And for instance, looking at the S&P sovereign rating being very close to lower thresholds. Now, if we look at the fiscal policy in particular, the sustainability of the debt, one important factor, in my view, is looking not only at the level of the debt, but the interest payment on the debt, which is, of course, influenced by the monetary policy, but influenced by financial markets overall and the high amount of savings globally. If you look at the German situation on the left-hand side, you see that in Germany, interest payments of the debt are less than 2% of GDP, while the nominal growth rate is around 4%. So you see that the you see that the debt is sustainable also in terms of interest payments, and they could afford actually increasing the deficit and using more resources to inject in the economy. If you look at Italy on the other side, it's the balance is very close. Growth is more or less in line with the total amount of interest payment on GDP, which is around 3%. This is the implicit payment. Of course, an increase in interest rates would rather make the burden of sustaining the debt more difficult. But in terms of conditions, for public finance, you see that there is room there for advancement. What about issues of liquidity? We talked earlier about corporates being highly indebted. The maturity of this debt is getting close to what we call a wall of debt, in the sense of the need to reissue in the next 4 years a very large sum of debt, and the market conditions may not be as nice as they have been over the past few years, and therefore at some point some tensions may arise in the market for this debt. And I will show you later that the quality also of this debt has been deteriorating in terms of collateral. As I mentioned, higher financial expenses and debt redemptions are likely to constrain the redistribution of value to shareholders. Accounting standards are making things, of course, a bit worse. So there are a series of factors which may together play a role in tightening financial conditions if a run is started in the markets. So the question is, how are we prepared to address a crisis or a bubble burst? Now, the usual thing that we all say is that banks are more capitalized. We have higher, you know, looking at all criteria. Incidentally, if you look at the liquidity side, the need to issue bonds on the banking side, this may become a bit more tense down the road in some countries in particular. So we are now in, SSM, supervision has become much tougher, and this is a good thing, although bankers tend to always complain, but I think it's at least initially it's part of a learning process, and the creation of a new institution requires a common effort also by the private sector. The central clearing we have mentioned, Solvency II, is of course concerning insurance companies, but we still have important fragilities, and we have to realize that we cannot just say that things are fine and that we are now better equipped to deal with crisis. There are still important fragilities. We know that cooperation has become more complex. We've seen the last G7 meeting. Some people are proud to be one against six. We remember in the last crisis, the cohesion of the G20 was key to address the crisis. It's not obvious that if a new crisis emerges, we will all be so coherent and so cooperative. The euro area architecture has still some flaws, which make it fragile in the event of a crisis. And we have seen in the last few days that, starting from the left, the sovereign bank loop is not fully severed. So we need to complete banking union, which means reducing risks, but sharing them better. And actually, when you reduce risk, you are able to share them better. And when you share them better, you reduce the risk. So it's a complementary process. The fragmentation of capital markets remains very high, and I think here the capital market project is too shy, too timid. We need initiatives which are much more, should be much more courageous, and I have the impression that this is out of the agenda of the leaders, but this is the real solution over the medium term to distribute risk better. And the stability mechanisms in the face of crisis, the common stability mechanism to avoid that countries have to address at as shocks, asymmetric shocks in particular, this is not being currently discussed. So the system has seemed to be completed, and the other worrying point is what happens if we have a new shock while, for instance, central banks have not yet normalized their monetary policies. If we look at the balance sheet, for instance, of central banks and their policies, and if we think of having a possible crisis within the next months or years, whenever they will happen, what's the room for maneuver that central banks have? And you could say that in the US they have increased interest rates, so at least they have the room to lower it. They have stopped QE and they're going to start reducing the balance sheet, so they could increase it again. In Europe, interest rates are negative, so could you go even more negative in case of a new crisis? That's not what banks like in general. So what would happen if we had a major crisis again? Could the ECB start a new QE? I'm not wishing for that, but if a major crisis happened again, would they have the room for maneuver? I think that's a question which is in the markets. The markets are asking themselves. Which doesn't mean that you have to get out and to normalize more quickly. Because this may disrupt markets. But it's just a question of, you know, what if a major crisis happens? What would we do in Europe? Another issue is the quality of the underlying lending standards, and I will come close quickly to the conclusion. We see that the underlying, this is a share of covenant-light leverage loans in the US. We see that the fragility of the system is increasing, of the lending structure, and what can you do in case of a crisis in front of this, a situation like this one. So, and of course, we cannot end any discussion about fragilities without mentioning Brexit. And you know, I'm told that I have 3 minutes left now, and I will not try to deal with Brexit in 3 minutes. But certainly, the biggest uncertainties for banks in the end, right now, and this is a message for you, is whether the Bank of England and the ECB will agree to something, and whether this agreement will be supported by the political system. And we don't have, as banks, this certainty today, and we are getting closer and closer every day to March 2019, and this is a real source of concern. So if I have a message for you, Yves, to get back to you know this very well, and you don't need me to repeat this, but this is really a problem for banks, in particular banks that are active in the financial system, then banks that are active in London, and the fear is that in the end the financial, we will lose a major financial system in Europe in favor of the US and Asia. So that's an important issue that I want to conclude. I don't want to give you only pessimistic views and the idea that things are only getting wrong, but I wanted to give you the impression that banks do manage risk, are worried about risk, and I think it's their business. They should not leave this only to financial and supervisory authorities and central banks. This is our daily job, especially in boards and in risk committees. I gave you a list of risks where we see possibilities of sharp adjustments in asset prices, because there are signs that some of these misalignments, price misalignments, everything up. It's very difficult to know when things will happen. It's I think forecasting crisis is easy exposed. Ex ante, the timing, I think, is basically impossible to anticipate. The problem is that everybody thinks that they will be able to anticipate them before the other, before everybody else. And this is a kind of coordination failure which leads to crisis. But our task is to focus on this. If we wouldn't, our shareholders, I think, would hold us accountable and we would have not learned anything from the previous crisis, which is not the case, I think. The financial system is maybe certainly more resilient, also because it's looking at these issues with much more rigor and much more intensity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lorenzo, for the speech. And just a short information, you received a form for Q&A. We will hold the Q&A session at the end of the third speech, but please hand in whenever you have your question ready.